Welcome to another BSO and Still Go Chat. My name is Tim Hall. I am the host for the series. I'm a member of Still Gold. I'm a saxophonist by trade and spoken word artist, originally from Detroit, Michigan. Came out to Boston in 2013 to work at Berklee College of Music, and currently I am an assistant professor there in their professional music department. Obvious member of Still Gold and session musician and spoken word artist around the city. I'm here with some incredible human beings who happen to be skilled at the art of being an artist. Oh, complex, I know. But we are here to talk about their lives and their inspirations and to listen to some music together and just have a really dope time. So I will jump into them and their introductions. We'll go Larry, Suzanne, Chris.
Well, hello all. Larry Wolfe, member of the Boston Symphony Orchestra. 50-year member of the Boston Symphony Orchestra. And people say, when are you going to retire?
Right? This is your anniversary, right?
Yeah.
And but there is a question. There are what we'll refer to them as wiseacres. Okay. And anyway, and people ask, well, 50 years, when are you going to retire? Is he getting bored yet? And I say, no. People like Suzanne Nelsen make sure it never gets boring. The Suzannes of my life are the ones, if I may say, that really keep my love of music going. I'm not going to retire. I'm 72. Give me another few years. I know I can still play in tune. I know I can still play in time. I know I can still play loud. And especially, you know, in finales of Mahler's symphonies, you know, I can play loud.
There you go. Awesome.
But it's been 50 years. I joined the orchestra when I was 21. And the first thing I did was refer to our principal. I talked to our principal cellist. I said, Mr. Eskin. And he said, if you call me Mr. Eskin, I'm going to hit you. So I learned to be on a first name basis with these gods of music. And pretty soon, every so often, someone will call me Mr. And I say, if you do that, I'll hit you. So it has gone around. It has come around. But I'm blessed with being, I was born to be a musician. And here I am having done it for my whole life. I'll never stop paying it forward. I'll never stop paying it back. I'll never stop being grateful, and I'll never stop learning. I mean, for all the music that I know, all the music I've learned, all the music I've taught, all the students I've taught, successful students too. Another one of my proud comments. The older I get, the more I learn, the more I teach, the more I realize how much I have yet to be taught, how much I have yet to be learned. I have yet to learn. My life is one of gratitude and progress. And I could only wish this kind of good fortune on everyone.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being with us. We really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Suzanne. My name is Suzanne Nelsen. This will be my 20th year in the orchestra. Love playing in the low bass clef with Larry and our buddies up in the back. I grew up on a pig farm. My kids hate it when I say that, but I did, and I feel it's important. I grew up on a pig farm in Alberta.
I want them to know this.
And my parents were opera singers, so it was kind of a weird mix. It was a good mix because you got the land and art. It was perfect. I went to school in Montreal, and part of my music choice was why I went to Montreal, and I'll get to that later. I played in the Montreal Symphony for 5 years, and then I, by chance, met this wonderful man, and I thought, how will I make this work? And he's American, and I thought, a job in the Boston Symphony came open, and I thought, I have to win this, and I have put my life on hold for music more times than I can count. I mean, and it's worth it. I don't regret that at all. Now it's paying back, and I like to give it also, like Larry said, pay it forward. And I've been, I won the job in 1999, started in 2000, and here it is, 2020. 2020 was supposed to be a better year. Let's
Yeah.
I think we all had that.
Jeez.
Yes. Yes.
Sure was.
Thank you so much for being with us, Suzanne. Super stoked to continue.
Wonderful to be here.
Yeah, I'm Chris. Christopher Talken is what I go by. I'm a vocalist in Still Gold. I've been making music. I've been obsessed with music kind of my whole life. It was always like the first thing that kind of like was an obsession for me from very young. So yeah, I grew up singing in punk bands and hardcore bands, and I was always involved in hip hop at that time through different avenues, I guess. I was really into breakdancing and and writing graffiti. And then, the music was always there. Hip hop was always involved in everything I did pretty much in life. And that kind of like spawned a lot of things for me, because through hip hop, I learned about all different types of music. That's how I first really got into jazz, from listening to Tribe Called Quest when I was young, wondering where all these samples came from. And they were very openly speaking about jazz in their music, the connection between hip hop and jazz. And so, and then that everything just kind of branched from there. And all these, growing up in and around Boston, just being, inundated with all these different cultures and music and things, that just kind of based who I was. And then I started making music with Mo. Probably Mo Pope was working on an album called Megaphone, and that's when we first started. We've been friends since high school, but yeah, that's when I first, that was probably 12-13 years ago. And then that kind of morphed into making albums with a producer by the name of Rain, and then that morphed into the early stages of Still Gold, and then now it is Still Gold to the fullest, five members deep now. So yeah, and then we find myself here doing amazing things with the symphony and stuff, so it's just great. It was kind of an inadvertent trip here, but I'm glad I made it,
And we thank you chose well.
Yeah, hey, it's the least I could do, Larry, is survive, it's the bare minimum,
right. Yeah, I mean, this has been, I think, the most challenging time that I've, had to navigate as an adult. Like, I think a lot of this was so unexpected. For me, I left my full-time job at the beginning of the year to transition to a part-time teaching role so that I could focus on artistry and focus on, building out my company. I'm here in my studio, Hipstery. I'm out in Cambridge, continue, we're working on stuff with Still Gold and whatnot. So it's definitely, it was a shocker, I think, for all of us, and like how to figure out what to do with ourselves now that we have this very real thing that we're navigating and figuring out. Are you all able to talk a little bit too, how you all arrived to your career? Could you share a little bit about, how you've come to be the professional that you are?
How about you, Suzanne?
Me? How I came to be, I played in bands, okay? You know what bands are like, with all the saxophones, all the flutes, the clarinets, and then one bassoonist, okay? So the bassoon part was never exciting. But, okay. And I had lessons at the time, so I was sort of better than the part. And I remember looking over the flute, like it was risers, and I'd look at the flute part and I'd have to like transpose it from treble clef and into the, actually, saxophone was easier because I could put it into tenor clef, and I read tenor clef, so it was better. I've got off topic. See what happens? So I wanted never to have to do that again. So I started orchestra. And orchestra, the music is better in a lot of ways. It's more heartfelt, although band music can be really good. I loved the breadth of emotion and collegial working together. It's like, I played sports too, but there was less injury in orchestra. No, not really. I mean, there's a lot of people in our orchestra that are hurt. So on a small, but it fulfilled me more, I think would be, it was more likely that I would succeed being a musician than being a sports person. So that's where I made my choice. And then getting to my piece, it was Mahler 1, and I was a youth orchestra member in the Edmonton Youth Orchestra, and Montreal Symphony came to the Jubilee Auditorium, and they played Mahler 1, and we were allowed to watch it as ushers of this hall. And I was sitting in there, and there's a point where the horn at the back, the sort of four or five of them in the back, stand up, and they stand, and I just remember going and just saying, I want to do that. I want it, you know, and went to Montreal, went to McGill. And then I got my first job in the Montreal Symphony playing next to my teacher, and then met my now husband and moved to Boston. So it was like just sort of everything went like that after. So Larry, what is your story? Oh,
I'm just enjoying the story because I'm glad it worked out that this way. Well, in my case, I grew up in the suburbs of Boston. I grew up in this town of Hingham with a very good public school music system. Oh, thank you, thank you. I will never stop being grateful for that. The fact is, in the fourth grade, I started playing the trombone because that was what Mr. Thomas played. You know, Myron Thomas, the director of music in the public schools, and I started with trombone for a couple of years. But I'd had much earlier in my youth, I had had tonsils out, adenoids out, and benign polyps. And so just this part of my throat that requires the most strength was the most stressed in my, so I kept getting sick playing the trombone. But that was determined that somewhere around the end of fifth grade, beginning of sixth grade, he's kind of grown into a big kid with these things, you know. And so they put a bass in my hands and it never stopped. As soon as I picked up the bass, I realized, you know, I have what I describe as hand-ear coordination. If it feels like this, it sounds like this. And I was good at that. I had it in trombone. So as soon as I got good enough, there was an orchestra in the sixth grade. I got good enough in the sixth grade that then Mr. Thomas picked me up in sixth grade and brought me to the junior high for that orchestra. When I was in the junior high, I was good. Mr. Thomas needed me in the high school orchestra. So I got in the high school orchestra. When I got good enough, I got into the Greater Boston Youth Symphony Orchestra. I changed teachers several times. I was taught by William Curtis, who was the registrar of Berklee School of Music, when it was a single building right where the Schillinger House was over on the corner of Newbury and Gloucester, I believe. And I took lessons on the second floor there. After 2 years, Mr. Curtis said, Larry, I've taught you all I can. I recommend you change teachers. God bless him for that. And then I went to study with Leslie Martin, also known as Tiny, of the Boston Symphony Orchestra, because he was a very big man. And so I got more interested in symphony music. And as I got better, there were always better orchestras and music festivals. And then as a senior in high school, I thought, you know, Mr. Martin said, why not? So I auditioned for the Boston Symphony Orchestra in 1966 as a senior in high school. I got in the finals. I said, maybe I got something here. And then went to Dr. Arslanian, who was then Arjun Arslanian, the conductor of the Boston Youth Symphony Orchestra, Greater Boston Youth Symphony Orchestra. I remember going to his house on Bellevue Avenue in Watertown and with my father. And I heard Dr. Arslanian say, I think you should put all your eggs in one basket. He did just about that thing with his hands in his chair with a little. And I put my all eggs in one basket. I went to Boston University for 2 years, New England Conservatory for 2 years. And as a senior at New England Conservatory, another opening appeared in the BSO. And I got that one. Apparently, I heard later, the committee was unanimous. Damn. That doesn't happen very often, does it? No, but... And there it starts. But thank you, Hingham. Thank you, Mr. Thomas. Thank you. You know, sort of a God-given talent. Thank you for there always being a better orchestra. But you know, there's no better orchestra. Not now. But still, how do I learn? The challenges. I mean, yeah, I know all that Western European music pretty well. But there are a lot of voices out there that I'm still listening to. In fact, Still Gold is one of them. I'm still learning. Well, I could go on, but maybe Chris, it's time for you to chime in. I could go on for hours. You don't want to hear it. It's not pretty.
I do actually. I'm very intrigued. I'm very intrigued. I'm very intrigued in other people's stories. I love to know. Same with music too. Like I've always been kind of a super music nerd. Like I always want to know the backstory, and who are the session players? You know, like I just like from an early age. Like I really remember being young, just nerding out like really hard about music. And it's funny for me. Like I never played an instrument. It was always frontmen and like singers was always like, cool. Like especially being involved in like punk and music like that. Like to see these frontmen just like take control of like of a crowd and just be able to captivate and like the raw energy of it all was like so enamoring to me and like it drew me in. I remember going early. I used to go to all ages shows at the Rathskeller in Kenmore Square when I was still there.
Been there.
We young. I'm 42. I'm not young. You know what I mean? So like I got to see a lot of cool shows at the Rat, especially the young age, like all ages shows on Sundays. That was huge for me. And then seeing these bands, like these touring bands, I got to see like so many amazing bands like come through and it was always the singers. Like I was just like laser focused on it. Like, and it was always like, and singers in general, like you'll see like when we play some of the music, like it was always very strong frontmen that always like captivated me, like you know, Little Richard and all these people with these great big huge personalities, and then like it's kind of like that was added a little bit to the lore of the band, like the all the, you know, like it just I was really into all those things, like that's what captivated me, you know. So when I got the opportunity to be in bands, I wanted that, you know. Like I see bands like Threat and like Bad Brains and these bands and these singers just the crowd, and everyone's just looking at the singer. You know what I mean? Like not knocking any of the other instruments, but it's like in those moments, it's like all about the words and the message and like, and people singing along and like that feeling of like, cause really when you think about it in a band at the time, the singer, the vocalist is really the only other instrument that people in the crowd can really partake in. It's not like people can bring their own guitars to the show, you know what I mean? Like everyone wants to be involved in that sing along, and that's just really having that much, and that's a lot for people too. Like that's you're saying a lot. People are really relying on your message sometimes. You got to be careful what you say, you know. And all of those things were very just attractive to me.
Wow.
I guess so. Yeah, and then being able to do that, I did was in that for forever. Punk bands, I did that for a long time and played shows all around Boston, all around. And then I moved away for a long time and I moved to Hawaii and wow. Then I came back. That's a whole nother story. We don't have any type of time for that.
Oh, come on.
All right, we'll sit down sometime, trust me. I'll tell you the whole thing. It's a great read. Yeah. So then, you know, linking with Mo early on, not in his career, in my career, actually doing music with Mo. At first, it was kind of Mo was like had asthma really bad. Mo has like really horrendous asthma, and he was like basically like, I need help like getting some of these words out sometimes. So like I need backup sometimes, you know. And we formulated this thing that it became very like. It became very symbiotic, and it was cool. Like, and we both grew up listening to these types of music, hip hop and punk and stuff, was just very innate in us. We were always into both of those things very much. You think it'd be a strange, you know, dichotomy, like it's a weird dichotomy, but it actually, those two music genres do make a lot of sense together. And we were always part of both of them, but we always wanted to combine it in a way that didn't seem like contrite or like real, like, I don't know, that those two genres put together can come off real corny and sounding like Limp Bizkit, like real fast. And that's something we never wanted to like cheapen it. We wanted to just make it something of our own. And that's kind of what we did. And then that eventually ended up to the sound of what STL GLD ended up being, or what is now still evolving, you know? So it's been a cool process.
How old is STL GLD?
Let's see. I say six or 7 years old now. I believe so. Three albums deep. So yeah. And I mean that's kind of loose too, because when we were making these records with Rain, Ark was always around, and he mastered a lot of those songs, and he mixed a bunch of that stuff. We recorded a lot of it at the Bridge. So yeah, I mean that was just kind of a logical progression for us, because Ark was just, he's so talented, you know. I mean that he's like, so we were this guy wanted to make music with us. We were like, yep, let's do that.
Is this Ark of Archetype Studios?
Yeah, he owns the Bridge Sound and Stage.
Cambridge. Oh, okay.
He's one of the owners. But yeah, so I mean, it's just the story how it progressed and to see it all has been really cool. And like adding all these, you know, Tim is our newest member, and adding all these amazing musicians, and we have like, you know, kind of other musicians we work with, Chris Black being one of them. Who did a lot with the symphony stuff, and I feel very blessed to have these musicians around us too now that we've always kind of just been friends with, and to be able to bring people in to jump on albums and stuff now is just, it's amazing. It's like the process is so great now, and it feels effortless, but it's not obviously, but it feels it now. It's starting, you know what I mean? Like it's getting.
It's been dope to like be a part of these conversations as the newbie, because like we obviously had a relationship before I was asked to join, and it was just kind of like, yo, this dude is really cool, so let's vibe out, let's hang out. We have friends that are in the same circles, but to also over time, you just kind of like you learning the backstory of a lot of like you all individually as well as collectively has been really cool as somebody who's, you know, newer and been dope to kind of learn about some of the history that might not like as easily come up in conversation because we're just used to being around each other and hanging out and vibing and it just is, but to like really sit down and hear about the stories behind the why and where and what is pretty awesome.
And the funny thing is about us is none of us were really looking for each other. It all just kind of,
yeah,
it just kind of happened. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like we never thought we'd have any more players than three people in Still Gold. And then all of a sudden it just, John came and we were like, wow, this dude, you know, not only being a great drummer, he's like, he's just such an asset to the band and like such a great person. And then Tim comes along and we're like, whoa, you know, so because with us, it's playing with people. It's like there has to be a love for the people as well as the music, you know, like making music with people that you don't find too favorable is not the most fun, you know, especially being in a band with people where it's like, it's a lot more than just playing music at this point. It's not, you know, so it's family now. So it's cool when that stuff can happen later on in life too. And later on in like the evolution of a group, I think is really cool.
Yeah. Well spoken. And it's funny, as I say, I have so much to learn. I mean, you'll most of the music that struck me, that got to me first, the most deeply embedded music is the instrumental music. And it took me a while to kind of, not warm up to, but join the world of vocal music and texts and messages. And maybe, in fact, that we can take a sort of a step sideways. It was through music that I met my wife, to whom I'll be married 46 years in about another 2 weeks. And she's a vocalist. I met her, she was in the Tanglewood Festival chorus, and I wooed and wed her back in 1974. Oh my God. My marital as well as my societal association with vocal music that is probably my next step. My next step as a musician is really understanding the message embedded in the words. I very often, I mean, Pam has a, she, I mean, I have a memory for my wife, his name, Pam, Pamela Wolfe, also a voice faculty at Brandeis University and a burgeoning home studio. Even now, her students love her and she's, as we speak, teaching online in another room over there. But I have so much to learn. I have so much to learn. And I, where Pam can, will listen to something and she'll be reciting the words and I'll be telling her what the harmony is.
Talk sounds like you're a good match.
Right. Yeah. It sounds like
a good team.
Pretty cool.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, but that's that's the next step. And Chris, that's what I'm trying to do is really, really tune in on the words and the message.
Yeah, it was a way. I mean, being able to get that opportunity to speak, because honestly, in society today, musicians have the biggest platform, pretty much in general right now, like pop culture and all. And so you have the opportunity to speak to the masses. You know, it's like, what are you gonna say? What do you choose to say? You know, and that's important because people are literally waiting on bated breath with some of these people, you know? So it's like, what are you going to say? And that's important. That's always been important to me. And it's always, you know, like you're given a gift to really change minds. And I never wanted to waste that opportunity. I've always wanted to, you know, speak truths and speak stuff that's relevant, to society and what's going on today. I've always been a big, you know, fan of like people that are, you know, champions of the unheard, you know, kind of being able to speak for people that don't necessarily have a platform or a voice. You know, that's always been, that's always been important to me, I guess.
Awesome. This is actually like a really good opportunity for us to transition into listening to the music. So, you know, all of the things that we are inspired by, or the journeys that we've decided to jump onto, come from, you know, a starting place of the arts and some kind of catalyst that music had in our lives that allow us to see a way forward in a way that's clear and exciting and fun. And you all were asked to share some music about things, you know, share music that inspires you or share music that, you know, connects to you in some kind of way. So how about we start off with Suzanne? Do you have a particular song that you like to get us kicked off with?
I talked a little, oh gosh, we could do MacArthur Park.
Okay.
I was happy to hear that on there.
Donna Summer.
Oh, it's a very Boston thing. It's a very Boston Cambridge thing.
I didn't know that.
Donna Summer,
yeah,
is Boston.
In Cambridge.
I did not know that.
Yeah,
there's like a big. There's a big festival that happens, like a dancing festival.
Yeah, they do like a roller skating jam.
Yeah.
Wow, I roller skated to her. I mean, I wanted to be her. I would sit in my living room with a pen and a string and sing my heart out.
Many hours of my childhood were me in the mirror impersonating everyone and everyone I loved. Yeah.
Yeah.
There was a lot of that going on.
Can I tell a really funny story? It's not really funny, but now it can be funny. I would have that pen and it was on a string, and at some point I would go like this with it, because that's what you do with a mic, right? I don't know what you do, but I found out the next day after I imitated Donna Summer that the pen didn't have a lid on it, and I had sprayed ink all over and the you know, the popcorn ceiling that you cannot clean.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it was everywhere. It was everywhere. So, yeah.
Can't get anything.
No. I just took it outside. I took it outside.
We'll jump in here to this. I'm excited, Ned.
Spring was never waiting for us dear. It ran one step ahead as we followed in. MacArthur's Park is melting in the dark. All the sweet green icing blowing.
big, like,
oh yeah,
dramatic intros into like just the funky disco hit, like.
That's right.
Yeah, she was always good for that.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, Donna Summer is amazing. She's that's everything. That Chez Vu when I was a kid, roller skating, like that was everything. Like, yeah.
Growing up in Detroit, even like we live on, my parents used to live on 8 Mile, and there's Northland Roller Rink, which is 3 blocks away from the house. In Detroit culture, a part of the culture of Detroit is this roller rinks. Like, it's such a big aspect of my youth and a part of our culture there, and it's, yeah.
Is it still there?
It's still going. It's still there. Wow. I don't know how it might have been impacted by COVID. To be honest, right. I haven't been back in a while, but yeah, it's definitely Donna Summers is like you can't think of roller skating and not think.
Donna Summers, you just have to. Roller skating is making a huge comeback too, like, which I'm super super happy about. Like, Shavu's still there. Shavu's still there. So Suzanne, don't want to go. Shavu's right there.
I'd have to, like, you know.
Yeah, bring your husband. You guys can, you know, couples only. You know what I mean? Like, it's still happening. It's right there. It's not far.
When the music nerd in me heard those compute, what do you call it? Those synthesized rototoms.
Oh, yeah, boy. You know it's coming. You know it's coming.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, the arrangement on that song is beautiful. Like,
it's good string arranging in the opening.
Just the drama and the
absolutely.
Donna, Donna is a diva. Like, the intro of the song, like, meets that expectation.
Sure. And, like, he's making an entrance, like, for sure.
The build and the grandeur of, you know, the movement between the strings and yes. Yeah, awesome.
Yep.
So, Chris, how about yourself? Do you have a song you want to get started off with?
I do. Yeah. All right. I'll chronological. I'll start with this one because this one kind of like started a lot when I was a kid. So growing up, like there was like a huge, my mom was like really into Little Richard, like really into Little Richard, like Little Richard, Chuck Berry, like that was it for her. Like, she was so in the car rides, it was always Little Richard, like, and Chuck Berry, and that's, so it was never lost on me growing up that rock and roll was not white people music. I'm glad I never had that twist on the narration that a lot of people had. Like, I knew from the jump when I heard Little Richard, that's what rock and roll is. Like, that's what everyone imitated after that, was, you know what I mean? Like, he, and just the way he did it, the like I said, like, frontman to me, like, just the everything, like the flamboyancy, like the whole theatrics of it, and he played hard, and it was fast, and it was aggressive, and he was screaming soulfully. You know what I mean? I'd like to think that Little Richard was a early precursor to punk rock and those roadie kind of, like, because you know, my other songs I chose, another song is a song from this band called Bad Brains, where the vocalist is really doing the same inflections. It's just a little bit more aggressive and a little bit, you know, but he's still hitting the high notes. He's still hitting the growls that Little Richard was hitting too. So it's, yeah, that Little Richard was the first thing that brought me into, I was drawn to him. My mom was really into him, so too, and that's what really got me going. And from there, you know, it was him. And I really liked Stevie Wonder really young, when I was young. I really liked Screamin' Jay Hawkins a lot. As a kid, I was really into him. I you know what? I think I always liked, like, spooky, like, creepy stuff. And I don't know. I guess he was kind of part of that. But Little Richard kind of, like, brought my eyes open to what it was to be yourself, and just, you know, because during there was, especially as a musician of color, like, that's like, being a black man playing that kind of music in the 50s was dangerous, like very dangerous. And he didn't, I'm not going to say he didn't care, but he had an air that I am who I am, and I'm gonna just, that's it, like it or not, you know? And at the time, he basically had to know that it was kind of a live or die type of thing too, because people weren't trying to hear black people play that music, you know? He was a champion to me in a lot of things. So that kind of, it opened my eyes a lot too, and I didn't learn a lot of these things till later on in life. You kind of had the chance to kind of just study them, but like just his struggles, just being able to play that music, you know, he fought hard to play that music. It's not like he was just, and he came from the church, you know, he was playing church music, you know, that's how he really got put on. So yeah.
To have to navigate church versus secular as like at that time,
weird path.
History, like it's still controversial now, but like that was at that time also just to have to navigate. And the interesting thing is that there's such a battle with that, but there is like gospel music wouldn't be what gospel music is without soul, without, you know, funk, without R&B, without jazz, and vice versa. Like jazz, funk, soul wouldn't be, you know, blues wouldn't be the same without the gospel, without the influence of gospel.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I mean, it must have surprised a lot of people too when going from doing church songs to, the song I chose is Long Tall Sally. Like, we know what he's talking about in that song. And that's definitely not some Sunday service music, you know. That's some Saturday night music, you know. That's
for sure. We'll play it.
Yeah.
Go to town and Mary bought Uncle John. He claimed he has a misery, but he's having a lot of fun. Oh, baby. Yes, baby. Woo, baby. Having me some fun tonight. Yeah. Well, long tall Sally, she's a bit of a species guy. Everything that Uncle John needs. Oh, and he ducked back in the alley. Oh, baby. Yes, baby. Ooh, baby. Having me some fun tonight. Yeah.
Very cool.
Wow. Like juke joint stuff. Like that definitely was not being played on the radio then, like at all.
Yeah. It reminds me of a scene from Back to the Future also. Awesome. Thank you for sharing that. Word.
Yeah.
It also, Larry, how about also brings to mind, you know, the fact that I was born in 1948 and the music that was that first reached my ears, you know, in the early 50s was not that music. I think probably I absorbed my father's at the time, the musical appreciation at the time, and he liked big bands. And so that was sort of the tail end, really invented big band arrangements, Billy May. And also my father liked Oscar Peterson and Art Tatum. Oh, giants of the piano, just giants of the piano. And maybe that's why I only gave you two short pieces on my list of likes, because otherwise it's endless. It's,
yeah, same.
It's just absolutely endless. But a lot of big band. In fact, in my particular case, I was thinking, I actually went through Spotify and found a couple of things myself, but still Billy May knew how to orchestrate his arrangements, not orchestrate, but the architecture of arrangements, so that he'd always save just when the absolute big band blast for about two thirds of the way through, when you just kind of just basically pins you to the wall, because everyone, it's just a wall of sound, you know, Phil Spector wall of sound sort of thing, but still, oh, but that is probably my answer to Little Richard, because it came a little bit before him.
Mm-hmm.
I know I dated myself, but still, but I only recently have just come to appreciate just the pressure required of a front man, just her personality for the actual leadership of the voice. I mean, the first voice you hear. It's amazing.
Absolutely, absolutely. So which song again is that you wanted to share?
For me?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, you can put, I mean, if you, well, I mean, I'll go with my original, the two pieces I originally put down as likes were not the only two pieces were from Mendelssohn, Felix Mendelssohn, because I guess somewhere in the third grade or something like that, I saw, you know, we had an assembly and we had a movie, and the movie was about the bloodstream, and the movie was called Hemo the Magnificent, you know, as in hemoglobin, fine. But in that music, all these little red blood cells are skittering around through veins and arteries, and you heard Mendelssohn, either the overture or the scherzo from Midsummer Night's Dream, and there's nothing that sits deeper inside of me than that music. Well, there are other pieces too, but they're, you know, it's partially just the same way you, all of a sudden a certain smell brings you back to an event you can't even recall. Mm. There's, you know, there's some band music of all things. It was the first band music. Yeah, Suzanne, it was the band music. It was Gustav Holst's Suite in F.
Oh, that's good. That's really.
I actually did an arrangement of one of those for Rick Ranti and string quintet.
Lovely.
But I couldn't resist. but that's the music that resides deepest in me. That music of Midsummer Night's Dream. You're welcome to play either the beginning of the overture or the beginning of the scherzo.
Okay, we'll start off with we'll do the overture.
Okay, with the wind chords. There they are. Talking about those first four chords that introduced they're the introduction to another world, the Mendelssohn world, a Shakespeare world. They're just magic, absolute magic to me. And some simple little things that Mendelssohn just did. Those chords, the last chord of the first of that chorale is E major. Music nerd moment. Sorry, the first chord of the Allegro is E minor. Little things that kind of slip you by, and then you think, "Ooh, what did he just do?" Mm-hmm. But again, this is the music nerd that on a bus, you ever been on a bus and you see the windshield wipers going back and forth in the front? I got as far as 15 against 16 before they in other words, they never go at the same time on a bus.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
And so I was counting, and it took me, I got up to 15 against 16 before they were in unison again. Welcome to my world. I do that to Pam every so often.
It's interesting being an artist because I sometimes people look at me and I've learned to own my like musicianness. It's like I'll like walk around playing air instruments, just doing this, and it's like little things that I do as a musician, or I'll hear a rhythm from a stoplight, or I'll hear something and I'm like, oh, I gotta sample that, and I'll pull out my notes app, notes app on my phone, and like I'll sample this noise to put into music. It's something. So just it's interesting also what you're like peaked by.
Isn't it cool? Isn't it wonderful?
Yeah, absolutely. And this is, I actually have a song to share with you all before we unfortunately have to end soon. But kind of like connecting to some of the conversation around intros and like how you start off a song, or like how you introduce a scene, like it's so important to think about intentionally how you start something off, especially within music. Like, how do you want to set the tone for the music? And I don't know if anyone listens to Jill Scott. Jill Scott is a super dope musician, artist, poet, vocalist, and her live albums have such incredible introductions as musicians. And for me as a kid, it was something that we studied as musicians who knew we wanted to be, you know, we wanted to back an artist. We wanted to be in hip hop, R&B, soul, neo soul music. And it was such a big part of like being a musician for an artist, is to be able to like come up with these creative introductions. So from her album, Experience, Jill Scott, there's this show intro that's just I've always loved, so I'll play that one.
That was
sounds very similar.
Very similar.
That's amazing. Music is crazy.
To like,
oh yeah,
listened and studied and replayed, and like it was a point where I was like times I couldn't like go to sleep easy because it was just playing in my head, because like we really wanted to exactly.
That's
yeah
I know yeah. I don't know because I can't play it, but I feel like I get it with like that. That's just like, it's crazy, like when you hear, especially riffs and runs and stuff like that, always got me too in music. Like stuff like that, like it's just like, oh, what? That's Craig. That's why I love Thundercat. That's why he's my favorite bass player, just because his runs are just, you know. But yeah,
I was trying.
That's like the part in the song that you wait for, you know.
You're like,
oh, I was busy trying to figure out the time signature.
Yeah, exactly. Like it's at some point, it's just like boom. But and a lot of it for us, like for me, a lot of that stuff I was learning by ear. We were learning things audibly in figuring it out from there. So definitely, definitely something I still know, something that still gets me excited to this day and thinking about how to build something and build some excitement. But overall, thank you all so much. Unfortunately, we do have to end the conversation here. And I really want to appreciate you all for sharing who you are, sharing insights into how you've arrived where you are, and sharing your time on this chat and this call. Are there any last, like, real quick things that you want to leave with the audience before we end here?
It's been kind of cathartic to have to come up with a small amount of things that affected you over your life. I mean, especially as you get older, you know, there's more things, but I am struck by how much stuff as a child still is so deep inside my personality. Like, you know, when I was 6 to 13 or something, before puberty and everything, it was just was part of me, still is.
Yeah, right.
Well spoken.
Thank you all. Yeah.
Thank you, Tim. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.
It's wonderful to talk to you, and we'll hope again very soon.
Absolutely. Yeah, and we have the music in a Spotify playlist, so you all will be able to also hear what the other chats added to this list, and we'll also actually be sharing that with the public, so the public who are watching the chats can also follow along with the music that we've shared, as well as music that we were unfortunately not able to share and listen through together. But you'll be able to kind of get some insight into the inspiration from the artists that have been a part of these chats. So again, this is Tim Hall. Thank you all so much for joining us for the BSL Still Gold Chats. Be on the lookout for the next chat, and be on the lookout for the series in general. So we're super excited to share this with you all. Hope you all have a great day.
Thank you. Thank you all. All best.